welcome to Shore's Edge. I hope you all have a lovely day, and I hope you enjoy your stay. Before we get started, our resident warlock and projectile octopus is not here today. She might be in chat. Shrogrill, say hi, watches your party. Hopefully it will not kill you and keep Hello. Your characters safe. And speaking of, I'm gonna get everyone in the rest of the party that's here today to introduce themselves, starting with Andy. Say hi. What you doing? Who are you? Where to find you?
Oh my, so many questions. Hello, my name is Emily. I am a local actor / D&D nerd in Perth, and you can find me on Instagram at Bebbingto. Yeah, my fringe show has ended, so unfortunately you cannot see me in all my glory on stage. But we have you here, that's what we're here for. Do I have to pass a baton?
Yeah, pass it upon to anyone but me.
We'll go with Nikolai.
Hello, I am Nikolai, he, him. I play a variety of characters here on Roll for Damage. For Shore's Edge, I am playing Solomon Brask, a detective dad who is out gallivanting, trying to find some purpose after his retirement. Pass it on to Henry.
Greetings, I'm Hardway Jones, or should I say Headway Phones, because I can't find my normal earpiece this evening. I stream on Twitch, and I also play D&D for fun. And today I'll be playing the lovable, if not a bit aloof, Githzerai Artificer, Huck Derry. Yeah. And passing it on to Dan.
Yeah, I guess. Hi, I'm Dan, after that. I'm your DM for this week and for the rest of the Shore's Edge season. And behind my back, the invisible forces that guide me behind the scenes is our lovely Pecky Reese from Nerds of the West. Find him and the rest of his gang over there. Check them out. And also must acknowledge our artist for all of the amazing overlays and arts from all of our Instagrams and things on Roll for Damage Repi. So go check her stuff out as well. Finally, the last bit of this segment is to our lovely sponsor that makes this show possible, Tabletop Swag. If you want D&D dice and all of that lovely goodness, check them out. They're super cool, good quality things, but they also gave us the power of giveaways. So throughout this episode, you can enter in !ticket or !swag to enter, and then we'll draw it at the end, and hopefully not one of us win it. Because we don't cheat. It's proper, the raffle. We hope you win, and you'll contact us and all that lovely goodness at the end. So stick around. Also, the finale, there's going to be a big giveaway, so do that too.
Ooh.
Stick around. So without further ado, somebody needs to tell our lovely audience what happened last week. How can you do it?
Whoa! Okay. We open to a tavern table where Huck Derry is seated and writing upon a postcard.
Dear Nemo, you won't believe the sort of stuff that happens here. Well, gosh, we've already fought one big monster, and then we got taken to an office of a really boring man, and he told us that he was going to hire us for either getting rid of the rest of the wolves that we fought, or we were going to go after some bears that I could not pronounce the name of. So we decided we was going to go after the bears, but Mr. Brask and everyone, they think that something sus is going on, something a little bit strange. I don't know what they're talking about, but they seem to think that there's
some big conspiracy with a coin and a disappearing wizard. Oh, speaking of which, Mima, we went over to a tavern and spoke to this real, real smart guy. A little bit of a jelly brain. Well, I say a jelly brain, not jelly brain in like the he can't think for himself like Uncle Earl kind of way. But I was thinking more in the kind of way where his legs are, you know, go to jelly whenever he comes across a monster. Anyway, we decided that we needed to have him in the party for some reason. So we naturally employed the jelly brain into our party. His name is Dietrich, and he seems to be hell-bent on, getting us from point A to point B. Speaking of point B, I hope it's close to home. I miss you terribly. I know you probably miss me more because it's been a month from your point of view. It's only been a couple of days from mine. I still don't know how this works, but hopefully we figure it out soon. Always yours, Hyuk.
Aw. Finish writing the postcard. You're still technically at the tavern, just finishing your lunch and your official short rest. So they've already pre-rolled their hit dice from before, and where's everyone at? On a scale of your zero to your max HP, where's everyone at? How's it going?
Like a solid 59 out of 60.
Okay.
On a scale
39
out of 44?
1 to 52, I'm feeling about a 52
out of 52. Ooh.
Yes.
Wow, somebody is sparkly clean after that lunch.
Certainly is. By the way, I want to point out for the sake of consistency more than anything, if one were to look at the postcard over Huck's shoulder, they would discover that it is in fact not written, but more of a childish drawing of various pictures of things that has occurred, because Huck cannot read or write, and I just remembered after I wrote the postcard.
So it's just going to be like
like a tapestry.
Yeah, a tapestry at the postcard. Sure. Dietrich is by with his satchel, and yeah, what do?
You got some talent there, Huck. The shading is particularly good in that area.
Oh, thank you. I was feeling particularly dark when I shaded that bit in.
And you see that it is the octopus under the water speaking strange eldritch patterns and a very terrified face of Huck.
Yeah, Abby's got some interesting friends. But hey, we've been dithering about a little bit. We really should get a move on these bears. Sort something out before they become a big problem for the town.
Okay. We hunting varmints?
We hunting varmints.
Righto. Let's get going.
You all packed and ready, Dietrich?
Yeah. I'm ready.
Wonderful.
Abby. Doesn't look good, son.
Abby and Abacus kind of looming over Dietrich, just examining the whole core of his being. If you just follow quietly, because I don't know what Shro would do in this situation.
During the short rest, Solomon would finally have taken the time to put on his armor, which is nice. Like old chain shirt that's got like a blue and silver pattern to it, bearing like a sign of the city of Ogdenwald as an investigator.
Cool. You just flex your rank when people might see you. I don't know. That might happen. Tell me what you know. Where do you go? What do you guys do? What's happening? You got your coin to spend. You still have your 5 uses of free stuff.
All right. Well, I guess it's a good time to test out this coin and see what it really does. Abby, maybe take some notes, see if any scarring shows up.
Sure. If she we can buries go out- her face with with the notebook and is just ready to go.
Solomon goes outside holding the coin. Couple of horses, please.
Just outside? You I don't just know walk how outside is... the tavern.
Yeah.
Okay.
Horses.
Nothing happens.
Aaron?
Nothing happens.
So it's not like a full-on magical kind of Dietrich.
Yeah.
Is there a stable master around here?
Yeah, it's actually the same place as the hospice. There's like the hospice, and then extends out as the farm, and then the stable is the same place.
Wonderful. We will make use of both of those. Likely.
Okay, I can lead you there if you haven't been. It sounds like you haven't been.
No, we haven't. We've been in maybe three places on this town, and had a fight in most of them.
Oh. He starts leading you to the stable area. Wow, I just had a mental blank. And then walks and talks. Like, so you guys were... Like, you fought the wolf thing?
Yeah. The wind wolf. Not too sure if it's got a name other than that.
Right. Usually the gods put names with things that, like, are new. And I'm pretty sure that one's new. I might have to talk with them later. But if you guys have fought him, they also, like, pulls out his own notebook, which is very worn from use. It's almost got a few pages remaining. And he goes, can you tell me what happened? What it did?
Well, Sprout, I think you were actually closest to it. You were inside its aura sort of thing.
Well, what can I tell you that the sheriff wouldn't tell you? Well, long story short, is a giant wolf that could form like a sort of hurricane around us. It was like a wall of wind that nobody could really get through. Very loud, very fast, very dangerous. The wind sort of just came from it. Like around it, like I don't know, but it seemed to be able to maybe manipulate the wind, but not super consciously, just sort of reactively to whatever it was doing. It was very odd. Smelled of flowers, which was weird.
Oh.
I don't know if you know any about giant wolves that smell of flowers, but...
Maybe it's just had a bath.
Mmm.
Do they have a dog wash around here?
Not that I know of. I'm sure there's a place if people can bring their pets here.
Well, I don't think it's anybody's pet. It doesn't seem very well trained. Kind of aggressive, if I'm being honest.
Yeah, has the landscape changed sort of recently for this wolf to come about?
Well, he flicks backwards. I'm pretty sure the Angelus happened 2 months ago.
Huh.
Yeah, and then we've had the forest up north, and then from the north east to the southeast is the meadows, flowery meadows area. Considering what you said with how, well, we have to turn here and he guides you. Considering that you said it controlled wind and made hurricanes and was really fast and smelled of flowers, did it have petals around?
Did we see any pebbles?
You know, I'm sure some got flung in my eye, but I'm not sure if it was making the pebbles or just tossing them up.
Oh, sorry,
the
petals.
Oh, petals.
Oh, flower petals.
Yep, yep.
Yeah. Sort of flurrying around.
Oh, well, then maybe it came from the meadows then. There's a lot of flowers there. But usually if they don't, well, none of the monsters really come here. They get close, but I don't know. I don't think I've ever heard a story of some monster going through here.
Very weird then.
Seems like things are changing because we rushed up on the beach and that never happened before. So maybe this place is running out of time.
Or maybe nobody really knows this place as well as they think they do.
Yeah. Maybe. And half.
Okay. Well, it's right there as he points. It's three buildings. One of them is very long and has a sign of what looks like an eclipse. But it's the sun at the top and then a crescent moon like a bowl at the bottom, and nestled within the crescent moon is a pestle to mimic a mortar and pestle. Beyond, there's a wooden barn looking area with lots of greenery sprout. You'd recognize a lot of the plants as very nice. Agricultural. In form and also in purpose. A few of which loom here and grow just fine as you walk, even though you don't think this is their ideal environment.
I suppose and you've got a good gardener on staff then, do you?
Yeah, I think the person that deals with the stables and the farm is I think their classification is druid. I've never asked though.
Huh. Interesting.
And kind of just points towards the barn and goes behind you guys because it's your. Alright, it's three there.
Emily? Ain't one of them things that you just talked about, one of them shamany things, ain't that what you is?
Well, yeah. It makes a lot of sense that they'd be taking care of the animals and the plants then. But, yeah. I don't know. Maybe I'll know them. Who knows? Very interesting.
She's got a friend that might help us get out of here.
Yeah. Maybe that too. Probably can also advise us on the best horses to get.
Or that.
Cool. I'm good to head towards the stable. Is that where we'd meet the stable hand?
Yeah, the stable master, farm stable master. Master of things that are alive and grow.
Hello, master of things that are alive.
And grow.
Howdy. Just looking to get some horses.
You walk up and you hear now the place is quite large. And that's the throng of people, guards with their own horses are like all the way at the very end of this long corridor hallway that lines all of the horses and things. It seems they're about to go on an expedition of some kind. And there, aside from the guards, you see, where are my notes? It's somewhere here. What? You see a burly but pale half elf with sandy brown hair, green eyes and sideburns, a raggedy tunic with dark brown pants, and the hall, the typical shore-edge indigo that is omnipresent on everyone who works here, that you realized, is actually located on his sun hat. that is just rimmed with an indigo ribbon and just lays down. And he just speaks up behind his back and says, I'll be there in a sec.
No worries. I'd like to go over to the guards. Hey, folks, are you heading out into the Undulus?
They not. Don't speak.
What are you tracking down?
We're doing the wolf.
Oh. How many of them are there?
5.
Bravia? I just... Watch out. Stick close to him. Otherwise, he gets a little defensive. Pushes you away.
Noted. So you guys are the adventurers who did the or encountered the wolf previously?
Yeah.
So we'll keep that in mind. They all collectively nod.
Do the guards... The guards are, like, employed by the town, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do they all have... Can I see their hands? See if they've got the same scars from, like, coins and stuff like that?
Make an investigation check. 19. The guard gestures to you for like a firm, respectful handshake to be like, yeah, that was a good information. And as he does so, you notice that no, they don't.
Okay. Well, good luck. I'll return back to the group.
All right. Thank you again. As he puts on his like armored gauntlets now.
They ain't got no scars on their hands from the coins, so they don't give the same sort of payment for the guards than they do adventurers.
I don't think that's a good sign.
I don't get it.
Just gonna hazard a guess.
I'm not sure.
Wait, hang on. So, that coin from the tavern, the one that Dietrich was saying was giving him bad dermatitis on his hands, you're saying that the guards don't get paid in that?
No, just something I'm observing, but you never know. May just be a hospitality they extend to visitors.
Mr. Brask, are you sure that you're not maybe overthinking this?
I'm just being careful and inquisitive.
Okay. I'm just saying.
Sorry to keep you waiting as the burly half-elf walks towards you guys.
Hey, we were looking to get some horses.
Oh. Yeah, sure. Do you work for the town or do you...
Yeah, I hold up the gold coin.
Oh, there are new faces then. Okay, sure. Where are you going?
Well, we're hunting down the Sith Bears.
I see.
Hey, Dietrich, whereabouts are they?
Well, White Gazelles are at the northern... Forest, last time I read a report, so there, please, says. Okay, Northern Forest shouldn't be too far. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, a little octopus, 5 of you. You're coming, little Dietrich. I thought you were holed up in the tavern all the time. He just kind of nods meekly. It's just all of that determination just deflated, just being here.
Oh, Dietrich's joining us to get a first-hand experience on the Undulus.
the half elf just, you hear loud impact noises as he tries to just give Diedrich the good old wholesome pat in the back and be like, yeah, you're doing it. Great, great job. I'm glad. He kind of just like whispers to you, Solomon, like, it took a really long time. Finally, somebody pulled him out of that house. He's supposed to be a researcher, so.
Yeah, and he seems to be the only one here now as well, so.
He keeps those notes close since he's the only one here. Glad somebody got him out.
Are we right in assuming that you're the druid in charge of this place?
Yes.
Oh, nice to meet you.
My brother and I run both of these.
Oh, lovely. Are you both druids?
No, only me. Ah. Only me.
Well, nice to meet you. I'm Sprout. I'm a druid myself.
Oh. Well, fancy meeting a... mostly druids don't come here, actually. So I haven't seen another druid in a long time.
Yeah, it's nice to meet one of our own, isn't it? So in terms of the horses that we're after, we do intend on arriving safely as much as we can.
Sure.
The
name is Milio, by the way.
Milio. Ah, lovely.
Mill for short.
Mill. Wonderful. What horses, what steeds would you recommend us for safe passage to the northern woods?
Well, I recommend you not using the horses in terms of getting there.
All right. What would you recommend?
The main purpose of them is to leave when the Angelus happens. The tone immediately serious. It's like the whole vibe of the barn just became thick and the tension high.
Yep, you mean they're trained to return without their riders?
Yes.
Interesting.
They come with you. You could use them for faster travel if there's a time frame that you need to be at. But I highly recommend you don't, just so they're not tired and can actually take you back home.
All right. Interesting.
Y'all don't got a lot of faith for people going out into the Angelus, do you?
No, he looks over. Diedrich is just a sweat-filled mess after the conversation has turned this way. But Mill keeps going. No, well, hard lessons are learned the hard way.
Huh. Can I turn to Mill and I think I'm going to ask him a question in druidic language. Maybe I'll pick another accent for this, who knows.
You don't need to.
No, I'll do it for flavour. Oi, mate. How often do these horses return home without their riders? How often does that happen?
Oh, yeah. Every time the unjust fucking happens, eh?
Well, that's no good.
So, we don't fucking know when the Angelus happens. It just does. So we give them horses.
So, real talk though, do adventurers usually die out there? Or do they just have to walk home?
You mean just normally without the Angelus?
Well, I'm more concerned with the Angelus, if I'm being honest.
Typical adventurer thing. of, you know, danger and life risking thing. So, you know, if we don't see them again and the horses come back, then we just assume the worst. Then we give them a few days and then we tell the administration, and then they do their paperwork, which I assume you guys have already done on in the case you guys disappear.
Well, yeah, I guess so. I'm just going to talk to my mates and we'll figure out what we are to do here.
Cool, I'm gonna tell sure, I'll get horses prepared. Do you actually need speed to get there? He looks over at the coin, which I just assume him. Looks like this is 5 uses. For the fast ones, it'll be 2. But for the normal ones, it'll be 1.
Give us a sec.
I'll be right over here, awkwardly standing at this pole.
Yeah, thanks, mate. That's perfect. Right, so it's a bit weird. It doesn't seem like they tend to lend horses to go to the Undulus very often because the riders don't return. So what are our bets that the landscape won't change while we're out there?
Are we going to brush past the fact that you just turned into like a drawl accent?
I'm so sorry. How rude of me. I was speaking druidic. Just a little.
Why was I scared?
Little thing. Why were you scared?
I don't know.
It's something new. I suppose people get freaked out by things I haven't experienced before. No need to worry though.
One guy I used to know from the swamp. He used to carry his kids around down the front of his overalls, and he would only jump everywhere, like hop, 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 hop. That's what he sounded like. We couldn't understand a word he was saying.
Yeah, look, I don't know what much else to tell you, but that druidic was actually, intended for people who were close to nature. So the only thing I can say is really that whatever it sounds like to you probably just sounds like someone who knows about dangerous animals and land and nature.
That makes sense. Makes a lot of sense.
I was just chatting to him though, just asking him to tell me straight up if adventurers usually die out there. Didn't give a straight answer though. So...
yeah, no one here does.
Very strange. They just kind of told us, like, well, it's part of the job to be an adventurer.
So... make an insight check if you want.
Oh, me?
Yeah, Sprout.
I'll go for that. Insight.
11. It is what it is. Take it how you will.
It is what it is.
Take how that conversation went how you will.
Right. Well, the question is how fast do we want to get there? Because for the super fast horses, it'll be like 2 uses with the 5 use coin. But if we get the regular ones, it'll just be 1.
I want to test out the effects of this coin with a smaller kind of measurement first, just in case.
No, that makes sense. We can get the regular ones then.
And if we're going to be staying around here a while, we might need the uses later on too.
What I don't understand is how come when Daedric used the coin, it made him all, you know, I don't want to say it because it seems a lot, but when we use it, nothing's going to happen. Is nothing going to happen?
We don't know yet.
Is it worth finding out? I'm just saying, they're just horses. We could probably just walk. All I'm saying, Mr. Brask, is I'm not sure it's worth getting, just for horses.
Well, we can use this as a test trial, and We need to get there sometime soon before they start moving towards the town anyway.
But the two uses?
We'll just do the one, maybe.
Yeah, we can get the regular horses. It'll be right.
We don't need no Mustangs or nothing.
That's the only way we'd find out what happens anyways. We'd come to this eventually.
Okay. But you be careful, Mr. Braska. You being an elder and all, I don't want you to hurt yourself.
I ain't that old, son. I can take a small scratch.
Whatever you say.
All right, Mel, we'll take some of your regular horse, please.
He almost snaps to attention as he just started to zone out and be like, how long will they take? No, that's funny. You had to talk, so I guess talk. Just the regular horses then?
Yeah, please.
Sure. And who should I charge this to? Which one of you?
I'll pay.
Okay, great. He grabs the coin, puts it. Yeah.
I wanna lean over to Abby. Hey, could you just get a good look at this?
Way ahead of you. The office has already like left. It's like started to climb in like on the foundations of this barn with its cute little eyeballs like trying to peer and like, get a good perspective.
It's a surprisingly mobile creature.
It is. Very much is. As on the Mill takes it from you and puts it like just on an unseeming piece of like wood, like one of the fencing. Just like puts it down, starts opening the doors and like get the horses out. And the horses are very calm. And Solomon, you've seen, and Sprout as well, seen a lot of horses, and especially for like military use and guard use and things, and these are well kept and also like well fed and quite healthy. You know, you can probably rely on them to run from the wherever you are back home. Yeah, he takes all the horses, does not touch the coin once after getting the question mark as he turns. So are you guys sharing horses, or should I just get like one for each of you, or for five of you?
One for each would be good, just in case.
Sure, yeah, that'd be great. Okay. He continues and gets a few more horses. Now there's five. And then with all the rope tied to the harnesses of the horses. He then grabs the coin, and there's a moment. There's a significant pause. Make, and everyone who's watching, make perception checks, please.
Yes.
I'm not sure I want to perceive what I'm about to perceive. Let's see now.
There's no hope.
Ooh, that's a low roll. I might not.
Yeah, you're fine. Everything's fine. Sprout, you do notice very briefly the faintest of glows.
Huh.
On the hand that connects to the rope, and that's it.
Interesting.
That's 11. You would have noticed way more than that. The event was any higher.
I have a plus, but here you go. As well, that's so rough.
Yeah, it's pretty sad. And then Mill just kind of hands them over to you, Solomon. Here you go. And here is your coin. There's four left.
Oh, thank you. How do I keep track of this?
How do I put it? Just think on it. No, that's very weird. I can't really. I don't know how to describe this shit, but the vessel keeps giving everyone of this, just think on it. It's like it weighs less.
Oh, okay. Neat. Handy.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for the horses, Mill. I'm sure we'll see you again soon, if not for more horses than for probably your hospice care.
Yeah, get home safe.
Thanks. Well, it was nice meeting you, Mill.
Nice meeting you. If anything, just like, it'll be such a sight to see you at the hospice with my brother rather than, you know, not at all.
Thanks. Appreciate that.
Good luck.
Alright. Saddle up, folks.
You know, Sprout, I'm still not sure what it is that your occupation, like, you said that you're close to nature, but what does that actually mean?
Well, for me personally, I'm, let's say, quite invested in, well, experience in nature. Some adventure is quite good. But I was trained to keep the balance in the natural forces. Make sure nobody's taken advantage of it. Which, look, I can't say for certain that somebody's in charge of the Undulus or something has been a catalyst for it, but that's my personal interest in it. I'm just here to maintain the balance in nature.
Just try to stop things from getting out of hand?
Yeah, well, some people with certain abilities don't have a good mind about it, let's just say. Some people like to use it for their own advantage, for their own personal gain at the expense of others, and gotta say, I'm not quite a fan of that. I think it's unfair.
I agree. I think everybody should be allowed to enjoy nature. And if a big swirling udder that sends dangerous animals to the land, then we have a right, a duty, to dispel with those varmints, or something.
Oh, I'm so glad you get it, Hook.
Oh, good. I wasn't sure I did, but thank you.
No, you got it. That's perfect. Yeah. Well, how about we investigate then?
Let's go hunting varmints.
See what these bears are up to.
We're going on a bear hunt. Gonna catch a big one. We're not scared.
I'm gonna turn to Solomon. Are your hands all right?
I didn't feel anything strange when it happened. Have I got any scratch marks on my hands?
Perception check. Sorry, investigation. You know your hands.
I definitely know my hands.
That's at 25.
Wow. Okay. Your knowledge of your hands has led you to believe that no, you did not have any scratches.
Huh. Alright. Gold ones don't work the same as the platinum ones, it seems.
Well, there you go. Let's hope it stays that way. Right, Hook?
Yeah, I'm relieved. I was worried that you was gonna wind up like Daedric, you know?
And I sort of gesture towards the scarred mitts that Daedric has clasped around whatever book or notepad he's looking at.
Daedric is on his horse, so just shelled up from, doesn't hear anything. He's like trying to psych himself up to leave town. He doesn't know you're talking about him.
Oh, good. Oh, these are all like full size, like regular horses, right?
Mm-hmm. They are full size riding horses.
Crowd, do you need a hand up?
Look, I wasn't going to mention it, but probably.
All right, all three. I'll fling you up.
Like a basket toss, like a cheerleader.
you guys get on your horses.
Clamber onto this horse.
Do you guys visit anywhere else, or do you head off straight to Adventure Time?
Adventure Time!
Yeah,
Adventure
I'm pretty keen. Time.
I'll clap Dietrich on the back. All right, come on, son. You're riding up front with me.
Up front?
Yeah, up front. That's where the action is.
We need an expert to lead the party. We didn't know where we're going.
Sure, bro. Yep. Yep.
Right beside you.
Okay. You ride alongside Dietrich up the front. Out through the town and northwards. Can I have everyone to please make me perception checks? Please.
Woo!
Woo!
Oh, would you look at that?
Damn. The squad's ready.
Eyeballs peeled.
Eyeballs peeled. You hear? What sounds to be like an otherworldly thrum? For the lack of a better word, it's like a deep, bassy noise that then transforms into this faint, high-pitched, harp-like strum. And you also notice that on the outskirts of town, further down the south, you guys are going up north, about to exit the town proper. You see faint flashes, just pillars of light disappear, and again, that seem to accompany it.
Anyone hear music and a light show?
I think I hear both and neither of those things at the same time.
That's a very confusing sensory experience.
Dietrich, is that some sort of ward on the town?
Sorry, what?
Hey, Dietrich, are you picking up on this?
Oh, that. He kind of glances back towards the south. That's the teleportation circle being used.
Oh.
Hmm.
That's mighty expensive, isn't it?
Yeah, and quite a lot of them, actually. You wouldn't know if... I would imagine it's people leaving from what happened yesterday. But... or today, rather. But... yeah, you can't tell if they're coming here or leaving unless you're actually there.
Hmm.
Well, I'm sure we'll figure out when we get back into town.
Yeah. Okay.
Who's in charge of the teleportation circle? Is there like guards there or a
wizard?
There
are guards there, but it's very bare bones. It's located on the outskirts of town, just actually on the border between where the Angelus occurs and where the, well, I guess the perimeter of the safety of Shore's Edge is. I'm not sure why there isn't like an actual outpost there. I guess they must have had like go through a security system to get here so we don't get like invaded or something. My master and I just went through his teleportation circle, so.
Your master has his own?
Mm-hmm.
Where's that one?
It's at the tower by the capital. Of the station.
Do you head back through the teleportation circle often, or do you stay here in Shore's Edge?
I've stayed here the whole time. After we've come back. Or after we've come here, rather. No, I haven't been back. He's told me not to.
Wait. He told you not to?
Yeah. So I can, like, keep researching.
He told you to keep researching.
Yeah.
That he left.
Yeah.
And you haven't seen or heard from him since?
I've heard from him. He sends letters, and I send him my reports all the time.
What does he say in his letters? Like, what did he say most recently? You don't have to give me specifics. I just mean, does it sound like
what?
Does it sound like he plans to come back?
Doesn't sound like he plans to come back. No, like our previous reports, because I've asked him when he was coming back, since, you know, there's a lot to process every time it happens. And he knows more than I do. I'm saying that, you know, like the luster of it has worn off, and but he still needs somebody to document what's happening, so it's not really that imperative that I figure it out. But he keeps saying that I should figure it out, but tells me not to come back. He just kind of, all of his recent ones are like, yeah, cool, keep up the good work kind of things.
Well, now, Patrick, I'm sorry that all this responsibility's been put on you.
No, that's okay. I think it's like a sign that he trusts me, right? That
yeah, of course.
I can handle all of this.
And you can.
Yeah, just make sure that the writings get published, you get a proper credit. Don't let him put it under his name.
Okay. Sure. As you guys walk now to the edge of the perimeter, and you see, hi mom, the wrong layer just for you guys. It's over here. There's a, it's like somebody drew a line in the dirt. The grass between the ones where you guys are coming from are like prairie grass, and there's no like flowers or anything. And the land immediately after is just filled with flowers. And just beyond, you see, like, flowers bigger than Sprout.
Oh.
Oh, wow. That.
My god.
Gosh. Good thing you're on a horse.
And just, if you have a pollen allergy, this is probably the worst place to be. But yes, it seems like just beyond that, the environment changes again. And you see the pine-esque trees beyond. Hmm. It should be through there.
Do the flowers smell like the wolf at all?
Make a perception.
Just by chance?
Yeah, as you travel through this little patch of the meadows up here in the north. 17, yes.
Oh. Well, that's a familiar scent.
It's not sickly sweet compared to what you envisioned previously or like smelled. Mm. But you definitely notice the tones in the air, specific smells of this section.
Solomon hands a handkerchief to Huck.
Thank you. Abby, have you got anything for this?
I don't know what's happening to you. What is happening to you? You call these... What are these?
Well, sometimes when the flowers get real bad... When I say bad, I don't mean... ugly. I mean, bad as in, you know, very flowery. Well, my eye kind of starts watering, and then my nose gets all itchy and snuffly, and my throat goes kind of hoarse, and I sort of swell up like a balloon.
Oh, okay.
You seem to know a lot about stuff. Sometimes, do you think you could maybe... help me out? Do you maybe got a magic something?
Nope. Lisa just keeps writing. That's happening to you.
Solomon's gonna go over to Huck, lay a hand on him. He's gotta cover one side of your nose and give it a good fuck. And he'll use 5 points of his lay on hands to cure a disease.
Okay, I'll give it a go. Just like a green. Torrent.
A green torrent of nasal mucus.
That's nice.
Stains delicious. The brilliant meadows over here, but it's so vibrant, nobody probably notices.
You think
so? Bad as a flower.
I feel much better.
You guys keep going. You now get to the perimeter between the meadows area and the foresty area. Same thing, which is very weird. It's like somebody just robbed this ground. Like, nope. The flowers don't go past the lines, neither do the grass and the other ones. There's a actual like gap that you can visibly see, but it doesn't extend towards the ground or anything. But it's like every plant at the very least respects their area.
Doesn't sound like plants at all. How weird.
Does the air feel different moving between the sections?
Make a perception check.
Make a perception check.
Perception check. 16. Yes. The ones there in the meadows, there was like a faint breeze that's always just perpetuating the sweet smell of the airs and all of the flowers. And when you pass through the boundary, there's none of that. It's like the air is still and, shall we say, significantly less fragrant.
So it's not just land that shifts and changes, it's the air and the space it populates above it as well.
An entire ecological shift, it seems, because the animals change too.
Diedrich nods off to the side. He's just been riding nuts this whole time.
I can't say I've seen many wildflowers just keep into their spot. It's quite a distinct line you've got here.
Is it like a teleportation between places?
Could be. Looks like it kind of jumps around a lot.
Well, make an arcana check if you really want.
You're the expert. Well, let's see. Diedrich, do you know Diedrich? Are you gonna be a person? Oh my god, Diedrich.
He's a person.
There's a reason we brought him along.
Oh my god.
There's a reason. There's a reason Diedrich was here.
Now you gotta explain why it is like this.
Here is a full report.
Wow, you have this all prepared?
Oh, I just figured that out recently.
This thing's like 30 pages.
No, it doesn't feel like conjuration-based magic, at least not between the two places. I don't know if you've been through like a teleportation circle before, but it's like pretty nauseous when you come out to the other side, unless you're like used to it.
Well, we didn't feel particularly nauseous crossing over the thresholds here.
Well, speak for yourself. I felt like I was about to get eaten. Then I woke up on a beach somewhere. I never want to see the ocean again. To say that I was feeling nauseous is an understatement.
Well, I meant more traveling through the Angelus. The ship situation was a bit more intense.
I guess that's true.
Okay, now that we're here, I'm not really good at these stuff, but maybe we can find some tracks. The quake gazelles look like little anthills. They leave behind little, like, hardened anthills, essentially. So don't panic if you see those. Those are just, like, hardened mud things. They keep generating mud, apparently. And then they quickly harden around their feet, and then they would need to move. So they leave behind these little anthill-looking things. That they're bigger and wider.
All right. Well, I'm not particularly good out in the woods, but let's have a look, shall we? Brought a little piece of the gazelle meat from the inn, just in case. Not sure if it's going to be enough to attract a bear, but...
I will gladly dismount and inspect the ground for some animal tracks.
Roll me a survival check, please.
Oh, damn it.
11.
Oh. I thought my proficiency would be better.
For the first half hour, you don't see anything. You keep moving. First half hour. Not an hour. It's fine. The sun is setting. It's now like after eating, it was 2, so it's now like 3.
3:30. Okay. No anthills. Is there another telltale sign of these gazelles?
Or just like he looks around at the verdant green. Well, aside from those like anthill footprints, if there's like a spot of like mud or like just a hardened piece of ground that shouldn't be there, like on a tree or something, then yeah.
What about dung?
I actually have no notes on how a fake gazelle poops or what it would look like.
I
don't think the guards told me that.
I'm good finding that kind of thing. The stuff that people generally don't want to find unless it's in a very specific circumstance.
Can I try to have a look for some dung?
Sure. Go ahead.
What should I roll?
It's an investigation check. You know what dung looks like.
Naturally.
Doris.
Slightly 14. Better than Sprout's roll. Only slightly.
I mean, your search time is cut down to 20 minutes instead of half an hour.
Yeah, maybe. Let's see. The roll of dung.
Dung had a bad roll. That's not hidden dung at all.
That's bad.
Yeah, that's 3. They went number 3 for dung. Door number 3. You see some dung, and upon close inspection, you start to smell some dung. Dung expertise. You have no clue what kind of animal would deposit this stuff. It looks like beads. It's a bead-esque kind of dung, like little spots, little balls.
Over here, look. I done found some. It seems to be kind of like little rocks, marbles. Maybe we can follow the trail, see if they've left some footprints.
All right, we'll lead the way, Huck.
From the dung, I would like to determine if there is any nearby footprints.
Oh, yes. You may roll a survival check.
Oh my.
Sir.
I'm rather proficient at that.
Who are you now? Well,
indubitably. Oh, really? Oh, we 16. Keep going higher, rolling and higher and higher.
The down quest took like 15 minutes. It's not 3:45. And after expanding onto that, it takes you another further 20 minutes, you know, like 4:05. And you do notice some tracks. The anthill things from what Diedrich mentioned before. And sand?
Hold on.
It's just a patch of sand in this verdant green next to some like four or more broken little rock formations. Look like a anthill.
What kind of sand?
Nature check, please.
Twenty-one.
Normal ass sand.
Ooh.
It's actually you with your 21. You'd know this is akin to how silt and sediment works, comprised of a lot of erosion of rocks.
So in other words, beach sand.
Not necessarily.
No. Okay. Well, there goes that theory.
Not. It's not the
one pin taken off.
I was like,
it's not the beach.
It's not the beach. Okay.
The sand theory is compared to Shore's Edge sand, where it was like almost porcelain white and like pristine, beautiful. The sand is way more earthy and brown in color, and like with the titular, you know, the yellowy sand.
Okay.
But yeah, it's fine grain, I suppose. Like the granular. It's very fine.
Can Solomon take a look at this suspicious sand and see if it's been dug up recently?
Sure. Make a, it seems like, well, survival actually. 12. The sand has settled. In terms of recency, you're not sure. But there is no tracks. And it just appears to be a pool of sand in this otherwise verdant green expanse.
Someone's gonna...
please, after you, Mr. Brace.
I'm going to take out this piece of meat that I got from the tavern and just set it down in the sand. I don't know. They don't have eyes and they don't smell, so they can sense vibrations. So we can just like stomp around a little bit, pretend to be gazelles, and I chuck this down and set a little trap.
How long do you invest in this endeavor?
I would like to assist.
In what way?
I've got just the thing.
Huck goes into his basket, pulls out two like forearm bones and sticks them on his head.
Oh, I'm a pretty gazelle.
And it starts prancing to and fro in a very very fawn like manner.
Witness me, for I am a very pretty gazelle. I sure hope there's no nasty bears around here to come and gobble me up.
And he starts stomping on the ground.
It's a brisk. Am I doing it right?
May I also assist in this?
In one way, Sprout.
Well, these bears like move through the earth and shit like that, right? I'm gonna cast. Well, they sense us through movements in the earth, so I'm gonna cast. What is it? Mold Earth. my cantrips to just kind of like shuffle around the ground a little bit.
Sure.
Just wherever Huck is doing his lovely performance, might I add.
Yeah.
Can everyone make perception checks for me?
Let's do that. Sort of a career on stage.
Oh man, I'm starting to see things now.
Oh goodness. 11, 10, 24. Solomon, this was your plan. So can you just roll me a straight d20 at advantage?
A straight d20? Oh, at advantage, sorry.
At advantage. 16.
Oh no. I just realized what that's likely for.
Sprout, you notice. Faint premise in the ground. Where are the horses?
Hello, us.
Well, looks like those horses were trained well.
They're very calm.
They are extremely calm. Just, I don't know what you've done with them, so I just assume they're just standing there, not tied to anything. Diedrich is still on his horse, and has actually started to evacuate to a nearby tree.
Hey, Diedrich.
Yeah?
Don't wander too far.
I'm just gonna be on this tree, hopefully. If it's actual bears that you attract.
Good idea. It's probably not good to be on ground right now.
Well, they did say they're like gophers, didn't they?
Okay, Huck, I need you to make a performance check.
Oh.
6. Excellent.
Beautiful gazelle. Am I not so luscious? Look at my tuckus. You could eat that all day.
Sprout, you see?
Yes, what do I see?
You feel the tremors more? Solomon and Huck still don't notice. And you start to see what looks to be the telltale silhouette of many gazelles.
Oh, no!
Oh.
Guys, I think something's coming.
The telltale silhouettes of many gazelles.
I'd say
as the canopy parts from this, just the slight breeze and the sun bears down to illuminate them, you see that they're where the flesh would be is cracked earth. The eyes seem to be hollow, or at least maybe they're under there and are peering out and you can't just tell. Through the cracks, there's this slick mud that keeps pouring out just ever so slowly with a goop-like viscosity. And at their feet, as one kind of like reaches the bush, considering what this fake gazelle is doing, the cracked earth almost moves up and down in rhythmic fashion, akin to a piston, and where they stand, that mud becomes shaped into a firmament, God, structure, or structure-like thing. Hasn't come through yet.
Ew, goopy gazelles.
I think your impersonation was maybe a bit too good.
Why does this one looking at me like that?
I sort of gestures to the nearest one.
It doesn't have any eyebrows through the cracked earth to really emote. considering that we've already had a very emotive octopus. But there's a, you hear the cracking of the dirt around its neck as it kind of tilts to the side.
I mimic it.
Make me another disadvantage performance.
Hook, I think you need to play down your playboy abilities.
You're a bit more like a goat now.
Okay. Well.
Oh no!
Sprout, make an insight check for me, please. One with nature, Sprout.
Yeah, that's an okay roll.
Even with the 12, you sense a disturbance in the air.
Do I?
It's almost as if there's like, for these sweet gazelles, there's like a little bit of killing intent.
guys?
I think we're gonna take a break.
Fuck, you pissed off the gazelle!
I guess we're here now. Who needs to hunt bears, but it's gonna be gazelles for days?
Is there a bounty on gazelles?
I'm sure they'll profit for the gazelles. We'll be right back. We'll take 10. Make sure you enter the giveaway. I'll remind you again when we come back. And we'll see you guys soon. As I try and figure out what the hell is happening. Take us away, Reese. Hello, welcome back. I hope you've stay hydrated through all this time. We've been hydrating, especially against now these gazelles. Today, I have to remind you that we have a giveaway. If you haven't entered yet, your exclamation point ticket or exclamation point swag to enter, and we'll draw it at the very end of the episode. So, race switches over. We were in a peaceful forest. And in the attempts to luring some bears with some meat on us on sand and a performance arch, interpretative dance from Hawk as a gazelle.
More of a goat.
It attracted the gazelle. And there seems to be, from behind, you see 5 now in total. Switches so over Reese, but it'll be over soon. It's fine. There's just 5 gazelles, but only one of them has like stepped up to the plate. Like it's as if to challenge you. It's like it's puffed up as much as it could. It's taking up more of its area and tries to like stretch itself out. You hear the cracking of the earth as its muscles and body move. And it points, it tilts its head down, horn first, towards you. You do the same. Okay. Tensions rising between Huck and this quake gazelle. Also, just with the, I don't know. Oh, pretty deep. Yeah, there
I'd
you
like
go.
I'd like to paw the ground just, with my foot, like kind of menacingly.
Yeah. Reese, I did tell you, but you can just click on the screen to remove the gazelle out of the thing. On the roll 20. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, look at you, Reese. little cursor cameo. As let's just roll for initiative, shall we? Huck versus quake gazelle. 1-on-1, unless people want to intervene.
I think Huck's got this.
Oh god! You think you're okay. So tough?
Make sure you...
here it is. Oh golly.
Oh, okay. I'll have to add your turn because you didn't do the thing.
Thing, I apologize. Yes.
That's okay. It happens. So, this Vixil goes first and tries to ram you. Charging forward.
Oh gosh.
Taking more insult to injury as a time to check. Yep. Does a nine hit?
Huh. No.
Gosh. No? A very telegraphed attack from this quake gazelle as it charges forward, and you just kind of walk off to the side a little bit, misses and stops before you, Solomon and Sprout, and Abby as well. They seem to be not mad at you. There's almost like a Sprout. You feel like you lock eyes with it, and it's serious. You feel some serious vibes as it turns around.
This gazelle means business.
The gazelle means business as you guys swap spots from that. That's its turn. So, Huck, it's your go.
All y'all stay back. This is the law of the jungle. I've got to establish dominance.
Are you sure?
It's no. A forest.
Yep. And just sort of leaving the femurs suspended from my like head somehow. I'd like to try and reach around and wrench this gazelle to the ground, like in a bear hug.
Oh, okay. That's a grapple check, so can you just give me an athletics check, please?
Oh, no!
Oh my god.
Woo!
It's gonna try again. Oh yeah, this is 16. It nimbly dodges out of the way, shocked, clear on its face for some reason that this gazelle only has two legs and has arms.
It's the gazelle from Adventure Time.
No, the gazelle thinks you.
Oh, right. I'm the gazelle from Adventure Time.
You're the gazelle from Adventure Time.
Mazel tov. What a fine mistake.
Uh-oh, that didn't go as planned.
Yeah, it dodges out of the way and... I mean, you have a bonus action and some movement remaining.
I'm gonna use my... No, actually, no. I go to I look towards my arcane firearm.
Huck. Don't.
Are you sure about this?
Is this a varmint?
No, this is like cattle.
Okay. Well, in that case...
Arcane firearm scuttles behind me. <What's>
We do this the natural way, as Sprout would want. Come and get me!
Brace for impact.
I did not say I wanted this. Huck, you can back away at any time.
Not until the king of the jungle has been established.
It's a forest.
It's a forest, I know.
That's your turn. It is now this unknown, very angry quake gazelle. For the people who are watching in the sidelines, Solomon and Sprout, you notice it's piston-like legs that start from the calves, like, pump more? As the Huck, you notice the goop-like mud that's been like just slowly flowing through its the cracked pieces on its skin has increased significantly. It's generating a lot more. And like a dog playing with a ball, they gather magically somehow off its body into a ball and almost flings it towards you with some kind of gazelle telekinesis.
Oh, that's a good trick.
That's a pretty good trick. And I don't know if a 14 hit you.
Nope.
Nope. You dodge out of the way. You see it.
Oh, wait, no. Yes, it does. It does hit. Just. Yep.
You get splashed on it, and it's almost like rolls quickly throughout your whole the surface area of your body, and it immediately hardens. Can you please make me a constitution saving throw?
Can I use my cosmic omen to help him out?
Sure, yes.
That is that
is a 12. That is a pass.
Okay.
Let's just say you would have failed if Sprout did not do that.
Sprout, is this the point we intercede and
yes,
and
I'd like to jump in.
after this round, we'll let you guys roll initiative. But as the mud-like goop hardens, you just shake it off. There's an inner strength that you gathered from somewhere as you just hulk out of it. Yep, you hulk out of the mud, the cracked earth. And yeah, it's incredibly shocked and tries to ram you again. He thought the thing that might have been easier. That's a 21 to hit.
Oh,
nah.
While you hulked out, it's already at ramming speed towards you, dealing a grand total of 1 piercing damage.
Hey,
the horns, while they look sharp, aren't. It just kind of prods you.
Stop
it! Anger still in its eyes.
That's it! I've had enough!
And I would like to, don't try this at home, chat. I'd like to take my shotgun.
Sorry?
And put the barrel of it to the top of my head so that the butt is at the top, and I would like to go and give it like a huge headbutt with the butt of the barrel while still trying to be a gazelle.
Okay. Can you just make me an unarmed strike, please?
Okay.
This is like so my pondering zone. I'm like,
in for a penny. unarmed strike.
It should be improvised. Well, I should probably count this as an improvised weapon, but like, it's fine.
Improvised weapon. Where is this?
Let me look at your sheet real quick.
Please do.
Well, yeah, you don't. Let's just do it live. Just roll me your strength score.
Yes, this I can do. Oh. Nice. Ignore the second one.
I will. 12. Yet. Oh. No, that doesn't hit it.
Oh.
That does not hit it. It dodges. Are you holding onto the shotgun?
I think that's probably a good idea.
Yeah, that seems like a pretty good idea. As you headbutt it, its head also moves because it didn't actually embed itself in you with its one piercing damage, so it could just easily move out of the way.
Oh, you wriggly thing! Come back in!
What the hell with it? And using my bonus action, I resummon the gun. Are we ready to start shooting?
Okay. Make an attack then.
My turn. That's my turn.
Oh, I summon the gun.
I summon the thing from behind me.
And, in what form?
So this time it has like you ever seen the hand from the Addams Family? Because I'm currently using its femur bones as horns to pretend to be a deer. There's just like a skeletal hand that it's this sort of primed on, this big old cannon on this little skeletal hand that's going around. Yeah.
I love that.
Cannon.
Yeah, cannon.
Yeah.
At this point, the other Quake is just, you could almost feel them roll their eyes at that display. And they just start to wander off. It doesn't seem like it was to you in particular. They wander off to this area and where they go, they actually part the bushes, and you didn't notice before, there was like a little pool. You were very close because of how there was the marks and some sand, but there's actually the faint, like very quiet, like stream of water that gathered to this pool, and there's this little rock formation off to the side, and they just kind of wander over there to take a drink as if all of the interest have just left from this new factor. And apparently one of their fellow friends was like, no, this is a threat. And they were like, no, it's not.
Is the one that was fighting me the alpha?
Maybe.
Does it look like it's got the biggest horns? Or?
It doesn't look like any of them actually have big horns. As in, none of them seem to jump out to you as the quote-unquote alpha.
So this one's the matriarch then.
It's just some dude.
It's just some.
Just the guy.
It's just a guy that you encountered on a street picking a fight. That's the vibe.
He's like Dane or something.
It attacks you. Well, the rest of the party intervene now. This is the start of the next round. Okay, everyone else roll the initiative. Diedrich is writing notes on the details of...
Yeah, cheers, Diedrich.
Quake Gazelle Society?
Probably also like a little subsection on the notes of just adventurers and stupid ants.
I should probably do dumbassery. For Abby, because she's gonna be part of it. Excellent, Abby. You're doing great. Cool. Now the Quake Gazelle continues to go first. And attacks Huck. For your hubris in entering these lands, just 20 to hit.
Yep.
That's a grand total of 2 piercing damage. As it does the same thing, but with more efficacy. It turned out that when it attacked you the first time, its quite brittle horns just like fell off, but in the process, it became a little bit punchier.
Oh.
It now has two piercing damage to you.
Leveling up.
Yeah. It's gaining experience by hitting a human.
Yes. Fighting against a training dummy.
Fighting against a training dummy, yeah. That's its turn. Solomon, it's your turn.
The gazelle is not that much of a threat. Solomon's gonna hold his hand to the ground and see if he can sense any tremors in the ground to see if the Sith bears are gonna approach this sort of disturbance that's being caused by all this.
Make me a perception check, please.
Ooh.
You feel tremors, certainly. You conclude that it's probably the gazelle and Hub. You can't tell. Yeah, it's very surface level. The tremors you feel are very surface level. They don't seem to come from further below when you just put your hand to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
You're not entirely certain whether this might be attracting attention, but if they can feel the ground, this is certainly doing the trick.
Okay. Then he's just going to move next to Huck, holding his shield, to just intercede any attacks that the gazelle's going to hit on him.
Okay.
Sprout, can you see if the Sith bears are around somewhere?
Sure thing. Can I take a look to see if there are any bears approaching?
Look? How would you try and... Oh, just make a perception check. Whatever, let's do it. Blanket, umbrella, 11.
Just check.
You don't notice anything in particular with what has been described to you by Diedrich.
Huh.
In terms of tremors in the ground. I mean, there's a lot of tremors in the ground, surface level wise, from the kerfuffle that's currently unfolding before your eyes. But you don't notice anything in particular. Don't see anything, hear anything. The four gazelles, quick gazelles that have just been vibing now by the water, are still drinking away.
Just having a sip. Is it my turn on combat, or is it still?
It is.
Okay, cool. Can I cast Mold Earth on the elk and try to like soothe it?
Oh, interesting.
You know, like blood bending or something, just kind of like try to calm it down.
Interesting.
It's okay. I don't know, calm its nervous...
only dreams.
Yeah, like calm down its nervous system or like relax the muscles or something like that.
Okay. I dig it. Can you roll me an animal handling check with advantage?
Animal handling. Oh, where's that? Oh, there it is. With advantage?
Mm-hmm.
17.
Ooh. That's pretty good. Let's see if this gazelle's pissy. How pissy this gazelle is.
Quiet.
It could get even more mad that I'm trying to fuck with its mud.
Hey, that's my mud.
Don't tell me to calm down.
My supervisor.
A weird sensation flows through its body. It immediately backs off, with some, like, not knowing what it is. It kind of looks around for the source. It's not smart enough to figure out it's you, Sprout. But it seems to have abated it somewhat.
Nice and easy now. No need to put this to turn into a real kerfuffle.
Well, I appreciate it, but really, I had it.
It's pissing like calves and legs slow down. The mud generating is less.
I don't doubt that you had it on the ropes. Just thought I'd diffuse the situation a little. We still have bears to hunt.
Oh, yeah, that's what we came for. Sorry, I think I might have gotten a little carried away.
He sort of takes the femurs off his head.
Sorry.
Puts him back in his basket.
The gazelle that you were fighting looks around and then looks back at you. There's almost like a... And then it looks around again as if trying to locate where its adversary was. And its adversary has vanished.
Friends?
And I sort of extend a hand to the gazelle.
It walks up towards you. Make an animal handling check.
I need this.
It licks your hand. It's very soft, like just the smoothest stone. And it like almost goes to like be nuzzled by your hand. It positions its head in such a way.
Hey, little fella. You ain't so bad after all. My name's Hook.
What a weird turn of events that was.
You're very welcome.
G Sprout. I think this worked out for the better. I've made a new friend.
Oh, he likes you.
Yeah.
That's so sweet.
I think he does. Can we keep him? Oh, Abby, Mr. Brass, Sprout, can we keep him, please? Oh, come, please. He's the only pet I've ever had that one made out of bones of dead family members.
Hook.
Wait, when
gazelle,
you put it like that.
White gazelle's a lot of responsibility.
Oh, I could be responsible, sir. I can't.
Are you going to feed it?
Yes, sir. Every day.
You're going to take it for walks.
Oh, I do plenty of walking.
How about we get you a starter pet first? Like a hamster. Yeah.
But this one's already said that he likes me. Look,
sort of pat the gazelle.
You pat the gazelle. It has like no fur, so it's just like your hands are muddy now. As you keep patting it,
it's kind of swampy, like me.
Oh, Sprout, what do you reckon?
Let's see how it goes. Let's see how this goes throughout our ride into the woods, all right? And if at the end of today things still seem fine, we'll have a conversation about it.
Golly! Sounds good. I'm so excited. I'm gonna name you. What should I name him? Billy. Billy the Gazelle.
That's a fine name.
Wonderful. Could use a little more alliteration, but otherwise, pretty good name.
I must make this happen. Hold on.
Billy the Gazelle.
Yes! Do it!
Billy the Gazelle.
I know what he's doing. This is great.
Bowman just goes next to Sprout and is like, oh no, he's named it.
There you go.
This is a problem.
Yes!
Billy the Gazelle.
Amazing.
It's a thing. Yeah, what do you do? Now that the situation's been diffused, there's still nowhere to be seen.
Yeah.
Sure, can I try my hand at like just kind of I'll do what Solomon did earlier and unbeknownst to me and like trying to feel if there's a disturbance in the earth in the soil.
Okay. Put
my hand down.
Yeah, make a perception check, please.
Oh, sorry, I still have advantage on. Do you want me to roll again?
It's okay. 13. No, that's fine.
Cool.
Let's see. Can you sense? You don't sense anything. There's a faint tremor, sure, rhythmic.
You call out to the tree.
It's probably the Quaker's elves.
Ah. Hey, Deirdrick.
Yeah?
You're right up there.
Yep, I don't know how to get down, but it's safer up here.
Yeah, fair. Do you know how we could lure out a bear by any chance? So we tried the gazelle thing and look where we are.
I think they're actually here. He points towards the pond area. And you notice now, everyone, that there's one less Quaker's elf.
Oh no.
Well, that's not good.
Where'd it go?
The other Quaker's elves seem unfazed.
Oh.
I sort of put an arm around Billy.
You stay close to me, buddy.
It continues to chew at nothing in particular.
Solomon's gonna go approach the rest of the gazelles, like, as softly as possible.
Okay, and roll me a stealth check, please. Did you have disadvantage from your armor?
Probably.
Sure.
16.
That's fine. Okay. You approach as softly as possible. You can nip yourself in the back if you'd like. And we'll expand out. Reese will do his magic trick. I trust. Trust in Reese.
He's gonna go to the lone gazelle.
Okay.
He's just gonna lone gazelle. Stay near a tree and just settle down a little bit, waiting for another bear to pick one off.
Okay. What is everyone else doing?
I think I'll follow, just slowly, cautiously approaching the gazelles. Can I prepare an action?
Certainly. What's the action to prepare?
I'll be a bit conservative. I'll prepare Thorn Whip for now, and I'll use it upon the event of a bear rushing at me.
At you, okay.
Yes.
Certainly. Where would you like to move? Grout?
I'll go here.
Okay.
Just cautiously, a little bit away, but close enough that I can see what's going on.
Cool. Ah, where do you go? What do you do?
That's a good question.
Yes.
How? Sprout. Yes?
Go over to the other ones, just in case.
Yeah, I'll scooch.
Gotta cover all bases.
I'll scooch here. Oh, here. Yes.
Can you make me a stealth check, please?
Stealth check. Yes, I can.
Sorry, I'm just removing beast. Don't panic, nothing's happening. 9. Sure. You walk over there. What are you doing?
I'm sort of... Okay. You come with me now. I'm sort of gonna lead the Billy over to where the horses are being kept and sort of put one of the reins around Billy.
Okay. And you stay right here and I'm gonna go make sure that everything's okay.
And I sort of look up the tree into where Deirdrick is.
Anything that happens to this gazelle, I'll make happen to you.
And
Can you roll me an intimidation check?
God.
This tiny man is trapped up a tree.
Yeah. There's an almost audible gulp.
Good man.
I would like to go over to where Mr. Brask is, or I don't know if I can make it that far without dashing, though. Would I be able to make it there? Are we out of initiative order right now, or?
You are out of initiative order.
Okay,
you
I'd like to
do like one turn's worth.
One turn's worth?
No, it's okay. Fine. It's fine. They move pretty far. You place yourself wherever you want, man.
Okay.
Wherever you want.
I'm gonna sneak up on Mr. Brask real sneaky like, just to not alert any of the gazelles.
Mr. Brask.
Here, Hook.
I've tied Billy up so he can be safe with the horses. What's the plan?
Well, right now, I'm being very, very quiet. And we're gonna see one of these bears pops up.
Oh, okay.
Ever play a game called Whack-A-Mole at a county fair?
Oh, well, not at the county fair, but I've whacked lots of moles.
Similar concept.
Okay. I'm ready.
Be very, very sneaky.
Okay.
Sort of holding the cannon.
Yeah.
I'm ready.
Abby goes to this.
The hand's just dangling from below it.
I need to make a roll a stealth check for me. And Abby goes to a tree, so standing like on one of the roots. So it's not like on the ground, but also has climbed the tree. And Abacus has glomped his way further up the tree.
Cute.
Yeah. Have you done your stealth check for me, Huck?
Oh, I do apologize. There we are. Rather stealthy, wouldn't you say?
Oh, so stealthy. Sprout, unmistakably, you notice underneath your feet the ground churn.
Huh.
As. And then you keep looking down and you see the ground before you turn into that kind of. There's a growing circle of sand that appears as within an instant a bird mass leaps out of this sand pool and attempts to grab you.
Oh my god. Ooh.
Holy shit.
There's a sudden... perfectly quiet. You didn't saw him and you just didn't see. You just saw suddenly bear.
Oh,
Bat Sprout.
Suddenly bear.
Suddenly bear. And suddenly bear. You're over here now. And the bear does the thing.
Oof.
Does a 21 hit you?
Does my prepared action...
Yes, you can thorn it.
Cool. It there's a 21 work. Hint. Yes, it
hits,
does.
Hits, yes.
Cool.
Okay. 24, yeah. You also whip it in... Where do you... You just... As a reaction...
Yeah, whip. I'd go maybe like through its... Like towards its middle, I suppose.
Yeah.
It's sort of like a reasonable... height for me to react to.
The thorns almost like a chainsaw, just like a lash. There's a clean cut on where you've dealt 9 points of piercing damage through it. And you notice as the whip recoils back towards you that the segments of the thorn whip that have interacted with the bear seem to have been like worn away, for the lack of a better word. Like, it lost some of its thorns. It feels frail. As the bear continues its momentum and jumps towards you and bites you.
Ooh.
There's a loud crunch. You're trapped in its jaws. It deals 14 points of piercing damage.
Oof,
and
ouch.
You are grappled. We're gonna roll initiative.
Oh yeah, here we go. It's a big bear.
That is a big bear.
That is a sizable.
That is a
earth sign.
Big bear. Time to roll. Wish these players luck because they're bears.
That yes. Yes.
One over here. And then back here, gazelle time. This one, and this one.
Yes.
Billy's not in this combat because being protected by Diedrich, and so is Diedrich. Because he Excellent. Would like to live, and he's put all of his efforts into defending the horses and Billy, because he'd like to come back home too, and not be shot.
That's fair.
Smart.
Okay.
I'll fucking beat it again.
Oh no, Abby. This is why I have everything color coded. There you go. In descending order, please. Cool. And switch over to this. Great. So, now that a bear has breached through the surface, you did not expect a bear to be completely silent, but you probably, since it doesn't have any eyes or nostrils or anything else or ear holes, it's probably also missing its what would be its vocal cords.
Ooh.
It looks very angry. It almost seems to glide through the air, making very little sound. In terms of its motions. Sprout, up close, you see its fur, much like the wolf from before, almost like blur. But now that you're very close to it, in its jaws, you can hear a very faint buzzing sound. Okay. We begin initiative with this random Quakerzel who continues to sip, unknowing of what is going on behind it. Huck. It is your turn.
Have I observed?
Yes. It's incredibly obvious. This just the ground suddenly erupted into bear and Sprout is in its jaws.
Sprout, Big Bears, Mr. Brass, Sprout, Bear. The varmints got Sprout! They got Sprout! They got Sprout!
And I would like to charge forward using all of my movement, dragging my cannon in tow, and using my primary action, I should very much like to unleash a shotgun blast upon said bear.
Certainly. Please make your attack with your shotgun blast.
Very well, very well. In good time, and like so.
That is a 3.
Marvelous.
With your sharpshooter.
Does it hit?
It does not.
I see.
Heat. You shoot, because it's sharpshooter, you switch to slug rounds.
I'm going to get the varmint!
And you shoot the slug towards it. And it's incredibly hard to miss something so large. And you see the slug hit something. You can't tell. And it's so, there's a grinding noise. And then it's not there anymore.
Huh? You varmint! You cheated me out of a bullet! Cannon, get him!
And I would like to pull on, like, grab onto a string and junk! Detonate the cannon.
Certainly.
So this one is going to be a activate Eldritch Cannon. Might try the protect. Oh no. Go the Force Ballista one. Yeah, Force Ballista. Yeah. There we go.
18. That hits.
Fantastic. That's 11, and I believe it's pushed up to 5 feet away.
Yeah, certainly. Ooh. A loud cannon blast echoes throughout the forest. And Huck, you notice the same thing through its trumpet burr, you suppose, or like the air around it. There's like a grinding noise, and then you make impact, and there's a almost hole on where the ballista pierces through its hide. And a moment later, the force pushes him off Sprout, or it's off Sprout, up here, 5. Sprout, you're no longer grappled, for the Sith Bear has experienced force movement.
Get on up, Sprout! Time for us to kill some varmint!
Is that all?
Yes, that would be all.
It did not like that.
The bear will remember that.
The bear will remember that. It is Abby's turn. And Abby's gonna continue to hug the roots of this tree. Going about. Let's see, it's over here. And then the, you know, typical very friendly abyssal water that's like murky appears in her hands as she casts Eldritch Blast.
Always gives me the fuzzies.
It's fine, Solomon. That's an 8. Hey, nay!
Oh!
Naughty stroke, bro. Natural 20 or 14.
Eldritch Blast.
Solomon, you see, gives you the creeps every time. The first bolt actually almost bend around the bear. And as it comes out through the other side, significantly weaker. But the second bolt hits it square center of mass, and it recoils in pain, still soundless, as it goes back into the ground. Or like on the ground. It's not in the ground. That's Abby's turn. Oh, I should actually, as a bonus action, summon a tentacle. So she does that next to Sprout. Because Sprout needs help. Yes. And wait. Oh. Tentacle whip. I'm doing you proud. That's 21 points. As another tentacle in the same structure and material as the Eldritch Blast water, it appears next to Sprout from nowhere in particular and slaps at the thing. You see it connect, and you see now the bristles frozen by the 8 cold damage are incredibly sharp. Sprout, you only notice because you're so close. Mm-hmm. But they jut out, and the slowed ones around it seem to oscillate in this motion.
Okay.
That's that's turn. So Sprout, you are no longer grappled. Technically still in melee range with the bear.
Wonderful. question before I do anything. Having grown up in the forest, would you say it's reasonable for me to have seen a black bear before?
Yes.
Cool. I'm going to use my action to cast a wild shape, but before I do that, I'm going to call. I'm like, hey guys, you want to see a party trick? And I will morph into a bear, like full animorph style. Just.
Oh my goodness. So you see that wicked transformation of Sprout into a black bear. And I must do this thing.
I'm very big and
scary. I was worried a second ago, and now not anymore.
A black bear.
Mr. Brand, look out!
Medium sized?
There's two varmints now!
No, no, not two, just the big one.
I must give this to you, Sprout. Because you're supposed to control it.
Ooh, I like
there you
that.
Go.
Yay.
You have your another sheet to worry about, and I'll just quickly rename this as you.
Yay.
Do not delete your own token, for we need to keep track of where you are in the initiative order, and you'll just vanish. So I'll just put you on over here.
Wonderful.
And that's you now. You're a bear. That's your action, because that's your... You're not Circle of the Moon, correct?
Yes.
I think.
No, I don't have... That's it.
Do you have a bone? Well, I would let you cast the bonus action spell before you transform into a bear if you want to.
Let me just see what my options are. Nah, I'll leave it at that for now.
Great.
Can I roar as a black bear?
Sure, I'll let you have that for free.
Mighty roar. Yes, thank you.
It echoes throughout the forest and all the... Yes. Make an intimidation check.
Oh my god, intimidation kit. Can I use my inspiration die from last session?
No.
I did say I'd use it for intimidation check.
Yeah.
So intimidation and then a d6, right? Yay.
Eight. You roar mightily. You scare.
Me. You scare me.
You scare me. I'm terrified of bears. I have a bear phobia.
Solomon jumps back. Right.
The bear has no ears.
You scare one of the cricketsels, the closest one to you. would be this guy. It almost stands upright from drinking. There's a shocked emotion on its face for an animal made of earth.
Has he just been drinking water this whole time?
Yes.
And you should Champion. Be too. You at home. Drink water. Stay hydrated.
Stay hydrated.
Good to you. I'm halfway through.
Where's the...
Chill.
Oh, that's your turn, Sprout. It's the bear's turn. And it bites it. It's a bear fight, a big bear versus a smaller but still big bear. As it bites you and attacks with two of its claws. Does a 22 hit?
Funnily enough, it does.
Oh, really? I assume then a 25 also hits, but a 10 probably doesn't it?
No, a 10 would not hit.
Ooh. Dang, that's okay. It bites at you. You're not the real bear in this neighborhood. For 13 points of piercing damage as it gouges it leaves significant holes like around your neck. And but doesn't grapple you actually, and a claw slashes throughout and deals 13 points of slashing damage
on the bear, right?
Mm-hmm.
Can I adjust that at all? No.
I think you should be able to.
Green is actually HP. That's okay. that I just rolled.
No, like on the bear token, you should be able to control it. But that's 26 points and your bear had 21 hit points, is that correct?
Oh yes. Does my bear just die immediately?
Yeah, your bear form disappears.
It was
very short lived. And you come back as Sprout that's over damage of 5. You take 5 from where you were. And that's its turn.
Turn into a bear.
it got pretty mad, actually. That's its turn. Quakerzell 1 continues to be ignorant of their surroundings as there's a big roar, but they just ignored it. Quakerzell 2 continues to ignore everything. Bowman, it is your turn. You saw your druid friend do an amazing trick of turning into a bear. Before it was quickly eviscerated by the Sith bear next to it.
Solomon's face just like dropped into worry from a Sprout being grabbed by it. Then he was relieved when she turned into a bear, and now it's gone back to pure worry now that she's not a bear anymore. So he's going to dash his way up right next to the bear, holding his shield.
Okay, Solomon, when you dash over.
Oh, no.
Got him!
You reckless person, you.
Yes.
You stop right here, next to this Eldritch Cannon. Potentially. Uh-huh. We'll see where it goes. It might not hit you.
Okay.
As if bear breaches from the ground. As you were told, there will always be more than one. Does a 15 hit you?
A 15 does not hit me.
No, you continue moving.
Oh, okay. All right. I'll dash up next to the bear that Sprout is next to.
It's now here.
Hefting my shield in hand. And these things are fully reliant on, like, sensations through ground and stuff like that.
So you were led to believe, yeah.
All right. I've used my action, but I'll charge up my Warhammer with a Thunderous Smite. Try to knock out their senses, what they have.
Okay.
So that'll be my plan.
So the plan is, if your hammer continues to have a Thunderous Smite, that the waves it's emanating currently would distort them, their senses?
I'm hoping when I give it a big bonk, it'll kind of like not really know where it's at.
Okay. Cool. And that's your turn.
Mm-hmm.
The Sith bear that surprised you, but misses, continues on the chase, following the footsteps of its prey that it felt. And he's over here. If I can just be on the correct layer and do my job. There we go.
Oh no.
Oh no, and it attempts to bite and claw you twice. As it did with Sprout. Does a 25 hit you?
A 25 does maybe hit me, yeah.
Okay, but how about a 13 or an 18?
18 hits me, 13 does not.
Okay. It bites you, like, near the back from turning away from it for 11 points of piercing damage. And then breaks as a follow-up where it clangs from your armor it was not expecting, for it cannot see. But the second attack, like, gets you where you don't have it covered as much after, like, moving from the pain for 9 points of slashing damage.
Okay. Yeah, I will do 2 con saves? No, my Thunderous Smite's gone.
That's okay. This is a good plan. That's its turn. And the Quakerzell, who was so intimidated by the Black Bear's appearance, and even more so that it looks around and it's not there anymore. Please, the scene.
Fair. It is a smart
choice.
Runs away. You don't hear from it again. Well, it is your turn.
So,
make a perception check for me.
Yes.
Underneath, below you, you sense from where the white gazelle fled towards that direction, there's also fine tremors that pass right under you to follow. It's gone now, you don't feel it anymore.
I think there's a third one hanging around. I think I just felt it pass under. Keep an eye out.
And see, unlike Mr. Solomon Brask, Huck was the opposite in terms of his order of worry, because Huck was relieved when the bear had dropped Sprout, and then Huck was worried when Sprout transformed into a bear and looked like the varmints that he was hunting, and now Huck is once again relieved that Sprout has returned to her normal state. However, once again, worried because there are now two bears on the surface and a third yet to be accounted for. So, in accordance with standard varmint handling procedure, Huck is going to let the bear furthest from him, as the locals say it, have both barrels. Again, attempt a sharpshooter shot.
You are in melee range with a bear.
The one that's not closest to him, I mean.
Yeah. But you continue to have disadvantage while there's an enemy in melee.
Really?
Not just, yep.
Oh, I had no idea. Okay. In that case, I might as well go
for the one in the way. Yeah. You don't need to be the to target them. They're like in the way.
Fair enough. I'll just go for the one that's closest in that case. Might as well.
Okay.
Does an 11 hit? Oh, it's a disadvantage.
But it does not. Just roll again.
Just get that one.
It does not hit.
It does not hit.
It continues. Alas. For your, it does not hit.
You varmint! Why are you so nimble, you fat piece of... Fine! Eldritch Cannon! Do your thing!
And I would like to, this time, Eldritch Cannon Flamethrower. If possible.
I don't think that's how that works. You get to choose what it is while it's out.
Yes, yes, my mistake. In that case, it shall once again be the Force Ballista.
Okay.
Which
is not in melee with anything, so it's fine. 13 just misses, I'm sorry. The same thing happens with the... It seems to grind whatever force energy comprises the bullet of the ballista. Dust.
That is, that's not good.
Huck is going to risk an attack of opportunity to sort of...
Do you dash away? Do you?
I have no actions or bonus actions, so I'm just gonna back on up.
Okay, you back on up. It attacks you, surprisingly.
Saw that coming.
With its claws, it's 21 to hit.
Ooh. That's gonna hit.
That's gonna hit for 11 points of slashing damage.
And as
it just rakes, it turns towards you, Solomon. You realize that it seems to now confuse the two of you.
Oh. As Huck was running away and it slashed at him, I wanted to use my reaction to use my channel divinity to rebuke the violent.
Oh, okay. Ooh. Sure, of course. Yes, you may.
Grab that one up. It's he has to do a wisdom saving throw. I think that fails.
I think that fails.
Okay, cool. So it takes the same amount of damage as radiant damage that it dealt to Huck.
Ooh. 11 points.
as it slashes towards Huck, like a radiant mirror image of the bear appears in front of it and slashes back at
it. Damn. The bear does not see the radiant image of itself and therefore could not really defend itself against the attack. Just somehow, soundlessly, an unknown attacker appeared that it couldn't keep track of. It's looking around. Failingly. That's it. That's your turn? We're still in Hook's turn. After moving?
Yeah, that's my turn. That's all I got.
Okay. Now, at this point, you notice, unmistakably, the sky itself starts to glow. Curtains of light start to snake around the whole sky as a scintillating aurora of all the colors imaginable just appear and bathe the battlefield in its dappled rainbow glow. And that's where we're gonna end off this session today. Because it's 10:52.
Oh no.
What? You can't leave us on a cliffhanger like that!
Oh,
it's happening again.
I'm gonna.
He's gonna! Oh! Fire out, Charlie Brown!
Ugh. Well, well. I hope you guys had fun over there on that side of the fourth wall. How are you guys feeling? You feeling great? Everyone positive?
We're just another statistic in Shore's Edge now.
As Bridge 184 in chat just said, well, the horses are returning with no riders again. This time they're going to have a gazelle with them.